Are we good to go? All right. Thank you for joining the afternoon session. My name is Sacha Faust. I'm a security lead at Lyft, and I'm co-presenting with...
Hi, I'm Alex Chantavy. I'm a software engineer at Lyft on the security team.
Good. Today, we're going to describe a little bit some of the things that we've been trying to solve at Lyft, and also how we're actually exploring our infrastructure, how we're trying to consolidate that information and share it out, so that not just security can leverage it, but other people as well, and start paving the way towards our automating our reasoning, automated decisions, as well around prioritization, custodian investment, like how do we do cell cleanups and things like that. So very often, we live in a world where many of us feel blindfolded, right? So would you like to live in a world where you're making prioritization decision with full context or as much context as possible? A world where you know the side effect of turning a knob here or an ACL and see the cascading effects of making that change. Many of us, or maybe I'm describing my experience, is I feel very blindsided or blindfolded when I'm trying to make those decisions at scale, right? So that's kind of a recurrent pattern that we've noticed. Also, we see a lot of shouting matches with the engineering teams talking with the rest of the company. The security team talking with the rest of the company. There's a lot of miscommunication. One is the security team says, hey, this is high and critical and because of so-and-so. And then the engineering teams or the other orgs are saying, well, I have to ship a product, right? So very different prioritization, different language to express things, different levels of sort of priority for each of them and risk tolerance as well. When I'm trying to kind of aggregate all the information about the infrastructure and people, I tend to get dizzy, right? There's too much information. At Lyft, we're cloud-based, so our infrastructure keeps changing. We are still a company that's moving extremely fast, high velocity. Change management may help to actually mature it a little bit more, but the reality is right now change management is a little bit chaotic. Just because of the velocity of the company. And cloud infrastructure keeps changing as well. So when I'm trying to synthesize all of that information to actually make a decision, I tend to get dizzy. I'm like, I'm sort of driving with one eye closed, and I'm failing to capture the whole context. So I'd rather, when I was kind of thinking through about this, I'd rather have like a comprehensive view of the infrastructure and relationship so I can start doing transitive analysis of that before I make decisions. So that's something that we've been trying to tackle as well. There's a lot of good investment across companies. Many of those investments are made in isolation, right? So many people own a piece of the puzzle, but we never really make an attempt to connect it. So for example, finance department may actually solve attribution problem, which is a big thing, because they want to know who is spending money for each YZ resource. And then security team is trying to solve the same problem because they want to know who to reach out in case of incident response or also assign tickets in terms of things to change. There's a lot of duplicate effort in trying to solve similar problems. So we'd rather live in a world where the pieces of the puzzle are well connected together versus own in isolation and eliminating duplicated effort. And also different ways of thinking about solving the problem. Why don't we try to solve it together? So Lyft was a kind of an interesting opportunity for some of us that have been in the industry for a while to actually come in and look at this from grassroots. Early on, a couple of years ago, we were looking at building the security at Lyft and trying to avoid the pitfall that we've seen elsewhere and start building a mission statement that was a little bit more pragmatic. A lot more in terms of collaboration and empowerment versus a compliance and friction type approach. So at Lyft, we try to empower, in terms of the security team, is we try to empower Lyft to make informed and automated decisions as much as possible. And with the release of some of our tools in the open source, we're trying to help the community as well. It's a great way we can share back, but we actually get a lot more than what we share because other people are using some of our solutions and it gets battle tested over and over across multiple companies. So just as a pointer, The content of this presentation is very an engineering approach to the problem space. We have another presentation from Lyft by Samantha Davidson around behavioral engineering at scale, how we're actually engineering good behaviors within our staff. So I recommend you visiting or and viewing that presentation as well, which focuses a lot more on the human aspect of things. This presentation is very, think about like a pure engineering approach of trying to solve some of the challenges that I've described earlier. So almost to this day, last year we released Cartography. So in the goal of actually automating our decision process, we are building a platform. So Cartography is really there as our observation and orientation platform. For those familiar with OODA loop or observe, orient, decide, and act, this is the observe and orient piece of our decision loop. And decision and actions are coming in the future. These are investments that we're incubating internally first, and then we will provide up to the community as well. So Cartography is pretty straightforward. All it does is build maps. It tries to understand the assets that compose our infrastructure, also try to correlate things together as well. Asset A and B are kind of joint together for some reason. And we also, through enrichment's job, so there's an extensibility aspect of it where you can add your own context. So if you know two assets are connected because you understand the company, you understand the context, we enable you to go do that. And this is through our open source platform. So if it's a bit ambiguous, let's dive into a little bit more concrete scenarios. So at Lyft, we use Okta as one of our identity platform. So Cartography is backed by a graph database. We actually use Neo4j. You can use other ones. I think AWS Neptune is another option that's becoming more and more popular. So what we try to do is schematize each of our asset management into something that we can visualize and document. This helps us build kind of a common language that when we're talking about Okta, this is what it looks like. Okta world is much bigger. This is a small portion of what we have. So internally, we have like applications and factor. We also have like admin roles and so on. But just for simplicity, we have a human node, which represents an employee. And that human node actually has an identity, an Okta identity that's mapped to an Okta user, and that user is mapped to an Okta group. So with this particular graph, I can look at anyone, any employee, and look at their basically Okta group as well. Now, when we augment this with our AWS ingestion, so Cartography is composed from multiple what we refer to as intelligence module that actually goes collect the information and merge things together. So this is a small representation of our AWS stack, which is composed of AWS account and AWS role. Now we grant at Lyft AWS access through Okta group. So by merging the two of them together and also having this enrichment capability, which is very contextualized to the company, we're able to create that allow by relationship between AWS role and Okta. So right off the bat with this simple graph, you can start asking question is, for that particular person, what do they have access in AWS from based on the AWS role? So you can ask question that is, the answer is composed with Okta and AWS very easily. So the same pattern continues with other ingestion modules. So we look at HR, for example, and we use part of our HR is backed by Workday. So we ingest part of Workday, and all we do is add the report to structure, so a human can report to another human, as well as team mapping. So by doing a very tiny investment, by pulling a little bit of data from Workday, we can now do aggregate view of, as a manager, what are all the access of my employees and my directs in AWS. I can look at, is there commonality as it should, but you can also look at outliers as well. Oh, we have actually, I have an employee that has access XYZ. Now, why is that? At least awareness is the beginning of change. So now we're becoming aware about deviations. So maybe that employee transferred from another role and we didn't clean up, or that employee has very specific needs based on the work that they do. At least now you can document that. And you can also zoom in and zoom out from a team perspective as well. So very tiny investments, and the scenario keeps growing and growing. So Another one that we've added has been G Suite. So same thing with Okta, we can add G Suite. We use basically G Suite at Lyft. So a human now has a G Suite user. And we found a pretty interesting investment from Duo Security on a Chrome extension. So Duo Security provides a CR Excavator, which gives you the ability to actually see Chrome extension installed on G Suite users. So by ingesting both this G Suite data and CR Excavator, now we can do risk analysis across all Chrome extension at our company. And you can start correlating if a particular employee has high privilege in AWS, which you can infer from that, you can now correlate with risk of Chrome extension, right? So if your admins in AWS have Chrome extension, maybe they shouldn't, or maybe you should use isolated identity for that. But now you can start quickly visualize and analyze this data, and then make a decision in terms of what you're going to change ahead of time. Plus, you can measure sort of effort and reward very easily ahead of time before making those change. So we just described a couple of examples of ingestion module and how they interconnect together, just to describe a little bit more in concrete ways what Cartography can do. But we have several other intelligence modules. Some of are internal to Lyft that we are sort of de-Lyftifying, meaning removing some of the Lyft dependencies and specific code and release to open source. So we have Jam, for example, which gives us device and ownership. We have Jira, which allows us to actually see in a particular service how to register bugs or follow up in postmortems. We have PagerDuty, which is super useful. That was very simple, allows us to map service on call, which can be very useful. And then we have VonDB and Onboard for our service mesh. Now we have visibility in terms of which service called which and what's the entry point there. So quite a bit of data available. And since it's open source, people can add their own components as well. Diving a bit more into the concrete world, this is an image. I've been to many security incident response. This is usually how I feel when they start. I'm either drowning already from the previous one, or I'm already feeling overwhelmed because I'm seeing the onslaught of like work item, people to reach out, operational awareness, like, okay, what is the context of this incident, and so on. So very often, an incident starts off with just a single alert. So Cartography, a lot of our demo are very AWS, because we are an AWS shop, but it doesn't necessarily just apply to that. So in this case, very often, an incident starts with an alert on a particular compute. And most people just see this, and now they have to correlate, like, who's the owner, who do we reach out, and so on. The view that Lyft gets is a little bit more like this. This is from the get-go. So we can, based on this mapping, and we've contextualized our graph because the service node is contextual to us, and we use enrichment job to do that. So for us, we have an instance that is alerting, and I know exactly the service that's mapped to. I also know who's on call. So who do I reach out directly? So I want to bring the right people in place as fast as possible. The very important step early on in incident response is bring the right people in place. So I know exactly who to reach out, and more broadly, I know the Slack channel associated with that service, so I can beacon something in the Slack channel and say, hey, something is up. We've already reached out to the on-call, but just as an FYI, as a team, this is what's going on. We also have a team and org owners. So in case of certain level of incident, executive support might be needed. If it's a SEV0, for example, where we stop everything and basically wake people up, we want executive support. We also want to have a reporting change to notify. So we have that information from the get-go as well. And we have like source code. We've mapped this to GitHub. We know exactly which source code has been deployed there. And for postmortem and so on, we have Jira to go start filing tickets. So very, very quickly, within a few seconds, we have all this information. What we've done, we've implemented some of those questions in our own Slack bot. So we leverage another open source project called OmniBot from Lyft, which makes writing Slack bot very easy. And all we've done is connect commands to certain queries in our graph and then spit out information. So Unfortunately, most of it is blacked out, just internal, but you can see some of the attributes of like team names, email, pager duty policy, team Slack, service tier, GitHub. So we have all of that. Now the next phase is instead of just querying that, you can just say start incident and it will grab all that information, bootstrap the new Slack channel, bring the right people in place and so on. So you can start having situational awareness down to automation as well. Now, that's the beginning. What about like how you do the investigation, right? So you have a compromised asset, and what else is compromised? The fact that you got an alert somewhere might just be that operationally the actor has screwed up, right? They may have made a mistake and trigger an alarm somewhere, but the reality is like that alarm may not be the beginning or the end of where they're going or where they started. Very often in incident response, we want to know like what's the blast radius? What are other assets that might be compromised? How do we prioritize log collections and so on? So again, orientation gives us that. So I'll go through very basic scenarios. Start with very basic and some a little bit more complex. So in this graph here, we can see that EC2 instance is actually connected to a service. But through service mesh and dependency, we know that the service is calling other service or SaaS vendor. First thing that you can probably denote from that is says like, well, that EC2 instance probably have credentials to those other services or SaaS vendors. You may want to prioritize rolling those out immediately. Getting that type of information in most incident response I've seen in large company takes quite some time or relies on knowledge, tribal knowledge or notes or runbook documentation somewhere, right? We have it instantly. Also in AWS is other EC2 instance may have been compromised or may have been touched or could potentially be compromised as well. How do you prioritize orientation in terms of which logs you're going to go gather and what you look for? So by analyzing the AWS deployment, we through EC2 security group and also AWS VPC, we already know all the other EC2 instances that are in reach, I guess, of that particular compromise instance. You can investigate them to actually see maybe they have more, those instances have more information and the actor didn't make a mistake and didn't trigger any alarm, right? But at least you have that situational awareness by doing more complex analysis in terms of what else could be exposed. Another aspect as well, this is gets it to a little bit more complicated, and this is also useful for your offensive team, by the way, right? It's like, oh, I've compromised an asset. I want to do lateral movement from one AWS to another AWS. So we've mapped out in Cartography VPC peering, the fact that you can actually peer two AWS account together. So in incident response, we have that view, and through the mapping of AWS VPC and VPC peering, we can see that that lateral movement is possible. So if you have, you know, the ideal case is that you have production isolated, the reality and some of the constraint as well is sometimes staging is somewhat connected. So it's good to know that they're connected, and it's also good to actually start investigating and says, hey, if they follow this path, we probably have some problems, more critical problems. So you can start pulling logs of VPC, for example, in a prioritized way instead of looking at everything. Same thing goes for SDS assume role. So we were very focused in the AWS world at Lyft, specifically around lateral movements. Some of us have had experience in Azure and looking at lateral movements. We took that expertise, brought it at Lyft with AWS. So we started mapping these things. But you still get a lot of very complex analysis available on the fly in terms of lateral movements. Another demo that shows the multi-hop or transitive analysis away from AWS that is still supported in our platform is in the case of device compromise. So if a device is compromised and it's managed and owned by a particular human, we can infer now that that human has identities, and those identities are probably baked into the laptop, right, or the device itself. And now we can join these things together. So you have a compromised device that's owned by a human. Human has Okta identity. Going back to the earlier scenario, Okta identity gives access to AWS role. AWS role has access to other AWS role, and it keeps going on and on and on. So some of the tools that allows you to do transitive analysis on the market are rare. Some of them are not working, or they're sort of a black box. We are trying to share as much as possible as some of the scenarios that we've thought through and also a way for us to actually capture that knowledge in a repeatable way. And that's available to our incident response, also available to our analysts. Like, don't wait until you deal with an incident to actually start investigating that. And our platform allows you to actually do all of that. So to dig a little bit more deeper and more concrete sort of example of how to use the tool, I'll leave it up to Alex that have some comprehensive demos there.
Thanks, Sasha. Hi, everyone, I'm Alex. So I'm gonna show you guys some examples about how we've built, about how to use cartography. And then my hope is that it'll show you kind of some concrete scenarios about why we are so enthusiastic about this tool. And before I dive real deep into this, I want to just get a pulse of the room. Like, has anyone here like ever heard of our tool or played with it before at all? Well, cool. And so at least one. The rest of you are in for a treat, I believe. So as Sasha mentioned, at Lyft we have Okta users. We use Okta. It's a single sign-on provider. And here in this view, I have user 123. And user 123, what I can do is we have it represented. User 123 has an Okta identity. And their Okta identity means that they are a part of an Okta group. And because they're part of that Okta group, we have it set up at Lyft that each Okta group is mapped to an AWS role. For those of you who are unfamiliar, an AWS role is basically the same thing as an AWS identity. It lets you become something. And so then AWS role belongs to a given AWS account. And an account is a notion of separation of concerns. So organizations will have separating, I guess, their assets and their organizational functions into different things that they call accounts. And then so far, so good. This is fairly straightforward to look at. We have what we have here is an example of a user, part of an Okta group, who is mapped to an AWS role that belongs in this account. Another feature of AWS that we have represented here is the ability for AWS roles to assume other roles. And what that lets you do is that it allows you as one role to become another, and it's part of the flexibility of the cloud in general. And one thing that that service owners may or may not be aware of is that this lets you cross account boundaries. And if you are on the attacking side, on a red team, or any sort of, if that's your area of interest, then this should be very, very interesting to you, because this shows you this quick visualization that if I somehow got this Okta token, it would let me be a member of this group, which would let me assume this AWS role, which would let me assume this other role that lives in this other account. So it helps, it lets you see these, breaking down these assumptions of isolation from a service owner's perspective. And a lot of the time, these relationships, they aren't necessarily very obvious or straightforward to view. You can try open up the AWS console and dig through all of those different config items, but you know, it's not exactly super easy to look at. And if you use cartography, you can go ahead and then ingest all your assets represented in this way, and then looking at cross-account dependencies is something that we are super, super interested in. And if we wanted to look at this fictional organization, we can go ahead and then zoom out even more, represent it not for just user 123, but for all of the users of this organization. So we'll go ahead, zoom all the way out, and then we can see that when it comes down to a medium-sized to a large-sized organization, this problem starts to look a whole lot more intimidating. This is a lot of data, there are a lot of paths, there are a lot of AWS accounts. And so I'm going to show you later on in the talk like how we take all of this data and make sense of it. And so this is all zoomed out, and then so the next question I want to ask myself is, as an infrastructure owner, how can I know which of my assets are connected to each other? So I'll dive into this demo over here, where Sasha mentioned earlier that we represent in cartography the ability to peer virtual private clouds in AWS LAN. Again, I'll reiterate that AWS is just one function. We just happen to be an AWS shop, and then it's our area of familiarity. But over here, we have this Acme account. It's got a VPC, a virtual private cloud. And a virtual private cloud is a virtual network, basically. It's got this, and in the VPC, there is this 10.47/16 subnet. This subnet happens to be peered to this 192 subnet slash 24. And so what, I'll zoom out over here, and we see that these two subnets are peered and via their VPCs. And what this means is that if I have a compute node in this subnet, then they have network connectivity to all compute nodes in this subnet, even though they live in different VPCs, and even though they belong to different AWS accounts. One thing you might notice here is, well, all of these other AWS accounts here, they have names on there. What's up with that? What's going on there? How come this one doesn't have a name? And in this particular example, this was pretty interesting because what we are showing here is that Cartography can get all the assets for this one account, get all the VPCs, get all the subnets, and then it'll discover VPCs in accounts that you don't control. So I'll repeat that one more time. So that's pretty scary. So that's a case where you have network connectivity to a VPC that lives in an account that you have no control over. And then oftentimes, yeah, sure, you can sift through your data and everything. You can look at it, and maybe you'll find it, but it's not as obvious as looking at it in this way. And we're going to peel back the layers of this onion a little bit more. Like, how can we take more analysis into looking at all of these assets? And one of those ways that we look at it is through, as Sacha mentioned, enrichment jobs or analysis jobs. So I will go back and show you about how those work. And so the question I want to answer with this given analysis job is, how can we identify if this Amazon EC2 instance is connected to the internet or not? So we do a good job of ingesting all of these different assets. What can we do? So we got all these assets, and then so we got IP range, we got IP rules, security groups, et cetera, et cetera. And then so what I can do here is I'm going to ask myself, we have the internet represented as that IP range up at the top, the 0.0/0. Do we have any IP rules that map to the open internet? Do any of those IP rules, are any of those IP rules associated with a security group? And then if so, which of those IP security groups are connected to a network interface that is associated to an EC2 instance? That is a mouthful. There is a lot of stuff going on there. This query is long. And if so, if all of this is true, let's set this instance with exposed internet equals true. Let's give it a little shortcut flag there. So that way later on we can go ahead and then query for all of our instances that have that flag, and then we know very quickly what's going on. Similar logic applies for a load balancer. We just go look, see if the load balancer has an internet facing scheme set right there. And then so set it right there if it's to exposed internet equals true. So you see that we can set attributes, but at the same time, I'm not showing it in that example there, but we can also set shortcut relationships also. So you want to have a shortcut for, we can draw a shortcut line if we wanted to go from that instance pointing directly to the internet. Okay, and then so now that we've established that framework, I'm going to show just what that looks like live. All right, so back to our organization. We have two different accounts, account ABC, and then this special projects account. And then in that other demo that I showed just earlier, we have a similar setup. We got the ABC account's got a VPC that's got a, let me close that. Got a VPC that's got a subnet, another subnet, and it's peered to this VPC that happens to be part of the special projects account. In this particular example, the special projects account, we are making the assumption that this contains all of our top secret stuff. We don't want anything to touch it. However, what is happening over here is our analysis job has labeled these nodes with internet exposed equals true, which is why they have this target on them. And that's why the special projects instance doesn't have that target on there. So this is a web-facing thing, and then so what that means is that this, all of these web-facing instances have direct internet connectivity to this instance also. They're able to talk to each other through the magic of VPC peering, through the magic of a software-defined networking. It's a convenience, but then, you know, and it's not necessarily a bad thing. Well, in this case, it's a bad thing because we made the assumption that everything in this account is going to be isolated. So making sure you have visibility of these assumptions is something that we take very seriously. And this is the kinds of, these are exactly the kinds of problems that we find very interesting to explore at Lyft, to explore with Cartography as well. And then so that's giving you a little bit of a taste of what we find interesting. I'm going to go ahead right now and then turn the mic back over to Sacha to give you a little bit of context on how we digest these findings.
Thank you, Alex. So we've described about a bunch of scenarios. Very often, we want to measure these things. We want to build KPIs, like number of admins allowed, number maintaining isolation, for example. So one of the frequent questions we get with Cartography is, hey, I want like historical data. I want to know how things are changing over on a day-to-day basis or like monthly, right? We didn't design Cartography with sort of a flight recorder or historical data. That's just not something, I've thought about it, it's quite challenging. It's not something that would allow us to actually release something very quickly. Now, on the flip side of that is you can still capture historical data. You can still build KPIs, for example, using Cartography. So what we do at Lyft is we are not building historical data capabilities within Cartography. That's an interesting engineering, but it doesn't really serve the purpose for us. What we are doing is simply codifying our questions. So if you want to capture exposure measurement, number of admin measurements, and so on, these are all questions, repeatable questions that you want to ask on a day-to-day basis. So what you can do and what we do internally is simply codify those questions in a query that Alex demonstrated for internet exposure. You can build all sorts of query there, and we run them every day. And then we capture the result and save it into a database. That's all we do. So there's, even though historical data is not built into Cartography, you can still pull the data out and save it on your own. And then from that database, you can connect your business BI platform like Power BI, Tableau, Lyft use Optic, which is a joint collaboration with Airbnb. So we come up with the KPIs, the chart, the measurements that are needed. So even though, again, we don't have historical data, there's a very lightweight way of doing this, and the open source project actually allows you to do that. Another interesting question that comes to mind is, like, I want to know when things are changing. One of the challenges in security is we don't really have regression testing. Like, we assume that these security functions or controls are operating. We test them once in a while. The test is somewhat, like, inconsistent and so on. So one of the things that we've tried to do is, especially in a very, very fast-paced environment, which is Lyft, we want to know when things are changing. We want to know when things are popping up. So how can we codify our expectations? So Cartography gives us that language to do that. And also, how can we reevaluate those assumptions all the time? So we've implemented drift detection, which is available in open source. We are consumer, obviously, of that at Lyft. So what basically the capability is, you can implement a question, and every time the question is being asked, it compares with the previous state. So Cartography doesn't have historical data, but when the graph updates, it knows about the previous. So you can establish a baseline of results based on a question. If you run, okay, here's all my instances that are internet exposed, we build up drift detection, which allows you to formulate the question and have a baseline. And then every time the graph updates, it runs the same query and compares the results. So it's a very basic diff. And then it alerts you whenever something comes up. You know, Lyft is fast-paced. We are acquiring new companies fairly frequently. Those companies need connectivity to our environment. And sort of claiming security knows everything that's going on all the time is like, it's not true. But what we've built is an engineering system that actually tells us when things are changing. So for example, I remember late night, I knew we made an acquisition and drift detection ran, and suddenly I got paged. It says like, oh, your internet exposure completely increased. Connectivity to your AWS, you're basically isolation expectations are no longer being met. So that was a good sign. It's like, oh, actually they turned the flip. I thought they were gonna turn it next week. It happened today, right? So that drift detection is, I have a saying, it's like, which is, I forgot who said it, but it's sort of a mantra for me. It's like, awareness is the beginning of change. So we're not trying to solve how we got there. We're trying to at least get that nudge that something is up. And then we can root cause and figure out how we got here. So drift detection is available in open source. What we've done internally at Lyft is implement reporters. So how do we surface this? This is an example of our Slack bot. We also have Jira and PagerDuty, depending on like the severity of it. For example, opening a new VPC, probably you want to know right away and get somebody looped in so that they can acknowledge the fact that, yes, this is actually correct, right? So you can start doing more kind of integration if you use Slack or Microsoft Teams.
So this slide is very near and dear to my heart. Thank you, contributors and users. And we know that we're not the only graph game in town, but the thing that we're not the only free open source graph in town. So, but one of the things that I think that differentiates us is that we have an extensible platform that lets you build on top of it. You can put you can implement your own data streams, your own data sources. You can add in your own organizational context through analysis jobs. And we also have a very cool fledgling community that we're starting to build up. And we're on Slack, so go ahead and check us out there. Come say hi. And we also have a number of very good featured work from the community that we use internally, GCP storage buckets, elastic load balancers, EC2 key pairs. You know, shout outs to Raman, Patrick, Marco, Zach, Mitsuhiro, Tobias. Thank you all so much. There's lots and lots of people. I definitely missed a lot of names. But basically, my call to action here in this slide is we want your feedback and we want your code. And you can get started as a contributor over there at our GitHub over there. And we particularly want help on our deployment story and our developer story in terms of improving the experience for both developers and users getting started. So we're here at RSA to go and ask for your feedback.
So just a quick recap is, based on how we started, is we're trying to remove that blindfold, like get as much visibility as possible. We don't claim we see everything. There's all sorts of, when you start like looking into human capital and some of the changes there in access and like processes and so on, there's a lot of stuff that we don't represent there, but at least it's the beginning. As Alex mentioned, our approach is we're not building a security specific tool. We tend to use it for that. But finance, we're very happy when we solve attribution problems. We kind of expected them to solve it. We've actually mapped the majority of AWS compute to actually real owners and managers. And they were like, oh, okay, you solved this piece of the puzzle. Oh, let me give you a little bit more context. So they started adding, and instead of us having about like whatever 70% coverage, we ended up having 100% coverage just because we sort of like paved the way there. So we're also trying to streamline our decision. So the complexity of our environment, we can start codifying these things more consistently and helping some of the decision process, as well as retaining knowledge, right? So every time you start codifying these things, people tend to move back and forth into different companies to acquire different expertise at loss. The good thing is we actually retain that. The transitive risk analysis is something that was dear to me in a previous role. I was looking at very large scale environment. I was very focused on offensive, and I couldn't build a mental map of all the doors I could do. So I really wanted to make sure that transitive risk analysis and look at not just like level 0-2 is like really full change and doing blended threats and so on was something that I was enabling. So your analysts can look at like all the pivoting and so on and figure out like the right spot to make the change. So that's something that's definitely available now. And building a language where we can all look at things together in a cohesive way. So there's a little bit less shouting match in terms of security engineers not being the best communicators and saying, this is a disaster scenario because blah, 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 and nobody understands. You can actually start coming up with a formalized way of describing these risks that other people can, especially the visual, more visual people can see, but also from a machine perspective is sharing that context very, very quickly in terms of automation. So thank you very much. As Alex said, like we love to hear feedback and get feedback in terms of how we can improve it and also how people are using the tool internally so that we can get better. One of the reasons we share some of our solutions is to accelerate our own progress, and hopefully we can help some of the other people in the industry as well. Thank you.
Yep. Check it out there.
We have some time for Q&A. If there's some questions, either here, Twitter, or if see some of us in the hallway.
Yeah.
Sure.
Does Cartography support any other databases besides
Neo4j?
No.
Okay.
It does not.
How did you guys get your data into that database? You've got Okta and AWS. What else? How did you get that data and put it in there?
So Cartography is kind of a plug-in thing. So I've mentioned we have intelligence module, which are components that are completely isolated. So, and those components are responsible to go fetch data from specific data source and then bring it together. And then enrichment or analysis job allows you to actually add the context to interconnect things together. So it's simple Python code that goes and query basically the SaaS vendor APIs. You can do this with AD as well. I think a good example, like Bloodhound does this in AD. A vendor solution, by the way, like JupyterOne, which is actually a vendor solution that looks very similar to Cartography, connects with AWS Neptune as well. So it's just basic API call, pulling the data in, building a schema first, and there's a lot of debates in terms of relationship and which they point. Yeah. But once you develop the schema, you just ingest it, and then you find a way to connect it back with the rest of the world.
Just to add on a little bit to that, each module has like its own structure where it'll get data, it'll transform the data, load it to the database, and then we have, like Sasha said, debates on like how to best represent it in terms of a schema. Cartography, it's like all we do is we ingest it, and then we make sure that it is in a reasonable way to represent, because that part is really tricky with the graph.
Yeah. Gotcha. So it just, you would build a new Python module for a new data source,
correct.
New,
yeah.
Right, SaaS vendor or whatever. And then the custom tagging you were done, is that done then in the Python module as well?
There's two extensibility points. You can add a new Python module, which is a little bit more expensive from a dev perspective. But when you actually ingest the data, all you want to do is analysis and do data augmentation, like just labeling and things like that. You can drop in, it's a simple JSON file that is a combination of multiple queries and set statements. And you can drop it in the tool, and it will just pick it up right away. So the analysis of internet exposure, for example, is an enrichment job that happens right after AWS ingestion.
Gotcha.
And you can do all sorts of things. An example with our HR data in correlation with drift detection is HR was kind of interested about offboarding scenarios. So we, based on the HR data, we will label a human node as, I'm sorry for the terms, but like ex-human, which is basically like ex-employee, right? And then drift detection looks at ex-employee node, and if they have any relationship identity, it means that our offboarding kind of screwed up and we didn't disable that. So those are kind of different it's still security related, but the ask came from HR, and that shows you a little bit like different data source and how all these things are connected.
That's all right. Thank you.
Yeah.
So I have a question for you. So like, can you kind of talk about the experience of getting traction for this? Like a lot of times, particularly in large companies, right? Somebody will say, hey, I've got this code that I want to release as open source. And then somebody else says, I've got a team of lawyers that I want to introduce you to over there, and then that's as far as it ever goes, right? So can you kind of talk about, like, how did you build the, you know, the capital to actually get the go-ahead to do this?
I got a story.
Sure.
Well, results speak for themselves, I would say. So this is kind of like part of the answer to your question. So one result that we had was, I'm very grateful for this, Zach, by the way, if you're watching, but then so what happened was, I had a requirement to add GCP storage buckets. As I mentioned, that was one of the contributions from the community. I put in an issue, and I said, it would be nice if we had GCP storage buckets in our graph. We need that visibility. 2 days later, Zach replies and he says, I'd like to work on this. And then so we worked together back and forth for about 2 weeks, and then gave him some instructions, and then boom, we had his code running internally in prod, and then it worked, got me my OKR met, got my requirement met, and then so the result of, we got a return on investment from open source immediately right there, and then so being able to go and tell, I guess, my boss and then my boss's boss and everybody else that we were able to get something from the open source community and scale ourselves that way. I think that speaks a lot to the success of open source. And I think that, I guess, at a place like Lyft, we're in general, like our culture is conducive for that. Yeah. Sacha, you maybe can talk about the convincing and stuff like that.
I've had failures and success. If you look at my history of employment, like some of my previous employers were not necessarily sponsoring these types of things. I think it's just a matter of like the culture and so here's like, I think a statement that I've seen used quite successfully is like, why are we saying we're good when nobody sees our stuff, right? So when early on at Lyft, when we're looking at like, how do we actually measure our own success? External validation was like pretty high on that list. Like we should actually be able to produce things that other people are using. And that's a good feedback loop saying that we're probably on the right track. And if nobody uses it, then we should probably like get rid of it. So at Microsoft, it was a complete different story. I'm familiar with the lawyer thing and so on. So I think it's just depending on the culture of the company. But like building, leveraging the crowd, crowdsourcing and leveraging the community is a big win. And yeah, some companies are just a little bit slower to do that. Lyft, for example, is from the beginning a consumer of open source and has contributed successfully. So I don't have a full-blown solution. I can describe a little bit some of the conversation more private. It's not easy.
Obviously, your use case is like AWS primarily, kind of a more modern enterprise. I work in more of a legacy enterprise, a lot of on-prem, and we get a lot of problems with centralized data collection. You know, trying to go out, reach out to all those endpoints is very difficult. Mm-hmm. Does Cartography at the moment support more of a push model of data collection, or is it all based on like pull data in from centralized endpoints?
It doesn't change that much. It's right now it's primarily a pull approach. We've been looking at more real time, which would require more kind of a push. You can implement an Intel module. There would be a slight challenge because you need something listening and updating the graph, right? And the challenge there is like as you get the push, you need to get rid of stale data. So we take a very simplistic way for us is every time we update the graph, we actually clean up the graph as well, and there's some mechanism built in place. I'll be hoping a little bit open to actually see more kind of a push model. It's doable, but you would have to make a few slight change there. Having, for example, an Intel module that is persistent and is also able to deal with stale data back and forth. But it is doable. Nothing stops you from writing back to the database. Actually, Neo4j is a push model, right? So there's nothing stopping you there. We just don't have a module that does it right now.
Awesome. And just in terms of scalability, like how many nodes and connections and things like that are you running at right now?
The max, this has been a long-term project with different level of iteration. We've scaled it to above,
you say
and
billion,
the two
right?
of us have worked together before. I think we scale it above a billion nodes.
Yeah.
Right? So
and that was with like clustering and stuff like that.
Yeah. So Neo4j offers clustering, so you can scale as Neo4j scale. We've seen a graph that is updated daily over a billion node, and probably 2 to 3 times more the number of edges updated daily with an engineering team of about 3 people. So
that
it's
said,
pretty
there yeah. are some scale challenges that I have in mind for open source. We can talk later about that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah. And anything question. Scale, go ask like Neo4j, and sometime you get like a decent answer.
I think we're out of time, but let's talk afterward. Find us in the hallway. Thank you all for your time.
Thank you.